If you want to learn how to make chiptune for video games that are based on pixel art or have a retro feel, stick around. This video is going to guide you through making this track from the ground up. Hey everyone, Jake from Transverse Audio here. To start making chiptunes, you'll first need a digital audio workstation, known as a DAW, and some synthesizers and effects. I put together a playlist with some free ones you can use in the card to the top right. You might want to grab some of those first so you can follow along with me. I really like to start out a track of this genre with a cool sound effect buildup to jump straight into the action. So I'll just throw on some white noise, and with this we can slide it from a lower note to a higher one by automating the pitch. To get to the same note in a higher pitch, it needs to be set to 12 semitones, each note being one semitone, and 12 semitones making an octave. By setting the pitch bend to 12 in the plugin, and the plugin wrapper's pitch range to 12 as well, it will move correctly. Without doing this, it may not work correctly. Now, if the plugin doesn't have a pitch bend parameter, you'll only need to change the pitch range on the top right. This goes for samples and loops as well. To make it easier, simply set the pitch where you want it to arrive and copy the value. After pasting it in the automation clip, you can change the curve to make it progress as you'd like. To give it even more progression, we can add an equalizer to filter out some of the frequencies in the sound and actually automate that. Before you add any effects, assign the channel with the sound to any mixer track and add the effect into that mixer. One way I like to make a transition with an EQ is by using a high or low pass filter. I'll just use a high pass in this case. A high pass filter is a type of curve you can apply to any of the 7 bands you see here. This will cut off or remove the lower frequencies and let the higher ones pass through, hence high pass. What we'll be automating is the position of the band it's applied to along the frequency spectrum in the EQ. This is usually between 20 and 20,000 Hz, which is the range of frequencies most humans can hear. There, now that we changed what happens to the sound when it's being played, we can add effects to change how it will sound after it is played, and it will let it fade out a bit smoother. Just so you know, these will change the sound as it's being played too, but that's not what I'm trying to use them for in this case. Let's start with reverb. To give the simulated space some grit, choosing a low diffusion rate will make it sound more choppy, which I think is pretty good for chiptune. Now let's add some delay to the sound, including the reverb since it's going to be applied after the reverb in the effect chain. You could always put the delay before the reverb to apply space to each echo instead of echo to the space. Sounds like it doesn't make a difference, but it does. For the settings, I'll throw the panning all the way to one side and set it to ping pong mode to bounce it back and forth from left to right. I'm not sure if it'll make a huge difference, but I'll drop the smoothing down to give it more of a rough edge. Finally, we can automate the wet signal, which is just whatever is processed by the effect, and have it turned off until the end of the sound to prevent it from making everything wash together while it's being played. Now let's kick it off with some arpeggio, and nothing too fast either. Those rapid sweeps up and down are usually good for quick sound effects throughout the song to keep things interesting. We'll add those later. To help it make an entrance, you can automate the volume to fade in. By copying the level it's originally at, it will make it much easier to bring it from zero to that level again. Now, time to go in and add some subtle differences to every second arp sweep, at least in the first part to keep it from getting annoying. Let's move into the bassline. Out of all the basic waveforms that are used in making chiptune, sine waves will translate the best, in my opinion, to lower notes where the bass will be. You can use anything you'd like though. I'll split the bassline into two parts. The first part will be consistent and will follow the movement of the arpeggio. To prevent this from being really boring, adding some automation will help keep things moving by fading in and out. Adding in the second part to the bassline, I won't have it present all the time, like the other one, and simply use it to guide into each bar, which are the four sections you see right now, divided by darker lines. Then making the last part guide to the beginning of the pattern so it will sound better when it loops. Okay, we'll put some percussion into this track, then we'll move on to making a melody. For some of the drums, I'll use DAWs Noisemaker, which is a great plugin even for stuff that's not chiptune. Again, you can find it in the playlist to the top right. It's under the best free synths video, not the one for chiptune synths. There's no real pattern you must follow for this genre, and what I'm doing is just listening to where the kick would make the most impact. Before I add in the snare sound, I'll just use a kind of a hi-hat sound to fill in the spaces around where I think the snare will be. Now for the snare sound. You don't always have to make all of the percussion stay at the same note either. You can actually use these to add some melodic elements to the music, not just impact. Since this will be looping often, it's good to guide the ending to the beginning, whether that be through the direction of notes or simply the amount of notes you use. Basically, it's good to make the ending more exciting than the rest of the loop. Alright, to prevent things from getting too messy, I'm just going to order my channels since I have them all assigned to a mixer track. Time for the melody. I'm just going to start with a pluck sound and just play around until I find a cool pattern to use. As you can see, I kind of suck, and it takes me a while to find something worth exploring. And that's the thing. Even if you're not good at playing the piano or other instruments, by experimenting and playing along with the rest of the song, you can discover even the tiniest section to then expand upon in the piano roll. It also helps in this case, as some DAWs will let you see the notes from other instruments in the same pattern, which can make it a lot easier to find out where to actually put the notes. And you know what? Not everything you make is going to be in the final track, so don't limit yourself to what ideas you have down and try out different directions. I'm not going to use this melody, for example, so I'll just try out something new. Maybe the typical synth lead instead of a pluck will work better in this case. When making it lead into different notes, you can add very short notes between the others to help it slide into the next. The beginning of the melody doesn't have to be very similar to the end either, nor does it need to be playing all the time, which actually could be a bit much for the listener. If you do come up with new ideas, it's also good to mute the notes you were using just to reference or use later. You never know where it might come in handy. Alright, so now for the quick arp sweeps I said I was going to make earlier. Don't go too crazy with these either. You should also take into consideration whether or not this will be played during gameplay, as adding these kind of effects to music can throw off the player if there are similar sound effects from the game itself. It's just something to be aware of. And when I said quick, these really do have to be quick, or they'll just sound weird. They may also sound better in a different octave or pitch, so don't be scared to try out that too. It's also good to use different kinds of arp sweeps to change things up a bit. Sometimes you need to cut out a few notes, sometimes use it for a segue into the next loop, and sometimes you might even need to cut out half of the effect, as it could be a bit too much. Okay, now for some bassy effects to use, as this track is kind of lacking some parts in the low end. By that, I mean it doesn't really have much character or sound present in the lower end of the frequency spectrum, which is anything below about 300 Hz. To make it more interesting, I'll add a delay effect and make sure it's snapped to the tempo so it can fit the rhythm and not be all over the place. As a final touch to the melody, I'll make the last part unique so I can edit it independently from the original pattern. This way I can give the song a cool ending. To make it even better, I can add some reverb and use a mostly processed or wet signal and fade it in so it turns from the dry, unprocessed signal to the wet one. You'll see what I mean. Now I can begin to tidy things up a bit and group together the automation clips to the track they were used with, then collapse them to keep things organized. Time to finish things up and set levels and equalize the sounds. Ideally, you want to set the levels during the whole process, then do some tweaking later on. It's important to keep everything below 0 dB, or decibels, to prevent clipping, which is a type of distortion caused by part of the waveform being cut off due to it passing the maximum level, which is 0. Now you can have the setting higher than 0, but what the actual sound reaches is what really matters. First, I dial in what volume I think everything should be at by running through and changing everything until it fits well with the rest of the elements. The reason I'm doing this is to allow certain things to either stand out or sit back in the mix. After playing the soundtrack for a bit, I noticed the melody could use another layer to give it some more thickness. Layering two different sounds together is not only great for music, but also sound effects. The key is to find a sound that will complement the other one by filling out some of the empty space in the frequencies. Now for some equalization, also known as EQ. By adding the EQ before other effects, we will be able to shape the sound before it's processed. You can always add it after everything, but I just like to use it as the first effect. Although chiptune is really basic in nature and may be easier to EQ, you should still take the time to trim off the unnecessary parts of the sound, and an attention to detail when it comes to this process. I do this by subtracting frequencies until I hear that I'm making a difference in the original, then I'll ease back a bit so I don't actually change the sound. Instead, just what isn't heard. Basically, all the unheard parts will add up to reduce the clarity of your song. Cutting these out will sharpen things up. As for the sounds that are always played together, I like to line up each of their EQs vertically so I can easily see where things need to be shaped according to the other sounds, such as where to cut or boost, depending on what I did with another sound. A very important thing to mention is that you don't need to EQ absolutely everything. I just think sounds that are isolated to a specific part of the spectrum should be kept there by getting rid of the rest of the frequencies that don't matter. And this is totally different for things that take up the majority of the spectrum. You might want to just leave them alone or trim out certain parts. There you go, we made a track. If you like this video, make sure to tell me in the comments below. I'd love to hear from you, especially if it's feedback that can help me make better videos for you. Make sure to subscribe and hit the bell icon to be one of the first to know about new videos I make. As always, thanks for watching.